Good morning and welcome to worship with Trinity Lutheran Church here in Boulder, Colorado on this fourth Sunday after Epiphany. It's so good to be in worship together, to come together before God, trusting that God meets us in the places that we are meeting across the distance and space, but uniting us together. We begin our worship this morning. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and the promise of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven and washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken, and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The hymn is 886, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Reading is from the 8th chapter of 1 Corinthians, verses 1 through 13. Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge, since some have become so accustomed to the idols until now that they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their falling, I will never eat meat so that I may not cause one of them to fall. The word of God, the word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus and his disciples went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught as one having authority, and not like the scribes. Just then, there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out in a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. They were amazed and kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority." Grace and peace be with you all through the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. New things are hard to get used to, especially when they challenge the way that you've understood the world up to that point. Now, it's often a joke in churches that when a new idea is introduced, everyone should simply just be prepared to hear some protest for the simple fact that we've never done it that way before. Now, of course, this is almost comical at this point, nearly a year into a pandemic that upended all of the ways that we had always done it before. Now, of course, the level of this response varies from congregation to congregation, for sure, but it's still present whenever people gather. Which means, of course, the churches are not the only places in our lives that we find resistance to change. Change a bedtime routine for your kids, and you're sure to have some struggle on your hands for a while. Get a new car, and you find yourself turning the windshield wipers on instead of setting the cruise control. Redefine some job descriptions or staffing structure at work to better align people's work with the needs in the office. And anxieties peak. Have an unexpected update on Zoom, and no matter how much more capability that update introduces, frustration runs high trying to figure out how to use it and wonder why the developers couldn't have just left well enough alone. Resisting change really seems to be hardwired into human nature, even if the changes are an improvement. New things are hard to accept, even when they address an issue that you've been hoping to have an answer to, though they're especially hard when they just crop up on you. Getting used to the new way of things can be uncomfortable, so uncomfortable, in fact, that we often turn down a helpful change rather than adjust our expectations. It's often easier to just stay with what we've known, but it isn't always what's best for us in that given time. In today's gospel text, we encounter Jesus just as he is starting out his public ministry, and he is teaching something new, and it catches people off guard. They aren't expecting this one. The story picks up just after where last week's scripture reading ended. Jesus is setting in motion God's kingdom coming into the world. He begins his ministry by proclaiming, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." And then he begins to pick up a few people to follow him. He calls Andrew, Simon, James, and John to follow him, and he tells them that he'll make them fishers of people. Here in the temple in Capernaum, they start to see what following Jesus and what the kingdom of God being near might really look like. And it sounds and it looks new. But it also carries a weightiness with it that doesn't make the people completely write it off from the get-go. It gives them pause to wonder aloud, what is this? They start off by being astounded by his teachings after he enters the synagogue. Now, we don't know exactly what he was saying, but it was ruffling feathers already. When suddenly this man comes up with an unclean spirit, crying out to Jesus, asking what he's doing there. Did he come to destroy the spirit? That's what the Holy One of Israel would do, right? Now, no one fights this. No one questions whether or not the spirit was unclean or real. Jesus just tells him to be silent. Literally, he says to put a muzzle on it. And the spirit comes out of the man. Now, we can get bogged down at this point and start arguing about what is actually going on here. Unclean spirits and exorcisms aren't often part of our daily vocabulary or conversation. And in general, they aren't really something that we tend to give much thought to at all here in Colorado. But that doesn't seem to be the case for the people at the temple that day. No one seems the least bit surprised that there is an unclean spirit in this man. That part isn't new to them. It doesn't throw them off. Now, I've spent quite a bit of time living in, studying, and observing various cultures around the world. Cultures can vary significantly and meaningfully, especially or particularly throughout the church, which is where I've spent most of my time observing how God acts and moves in different cultures in different ways. And one thing that I have repeatedly observed is that God is not consistent in how God acts, but is consistent to an extent within certain contexts. It seems that God does do things a little differently depending on what the world around is understanding about how things work. And I've learned that I can't just jump in and discredit these experiences because I don't understand them from where I'm coming from. Now, that was definitely true when I was in Liberia in West Africa, where it was very common to talk about people being cursed by bad spirits, both inside and outside the church. It was part of the larger culture. Every day, everyone understood that this was simply part of the experience of life. Now I had to think about things in a way I had never thought about them before. If an entire culture around understood that spirit possession was a reality, it would actually be a little bit odd for that experience not to happen in the church too. And again, it seemed that they experienced it there as well, in Lutheran churches. We've come into these types of experiences by looking to the people around them and seeing them and looking to see how they react and interpret it. And when we do that, we have a lot better chance of not getting astounded by things that aren't all that interesting. The culture that we find Jesus in seems to have some similar assumptions here. So again, writing off this story because the spirit possession thing may not make sense to us right here probably isn't all that helpful. And it's not what's causing jaws to drop within the story at all. The thing that they are amazed by, though, the thing that completely throws them off is that Jesus somehow has the authority, a new authority, to tell these spirits what to do. And Jesus tells this spirit to be quiet and to get lost. Jesus has power to change the way of things like they've never seen before. And that gets their attention. Jesus has something new to reveal about how God works in the world, where the kingdom of God is coming near. This new teaching shows that the kingdom of God is not going to be one where things that keep us apart from God and the community are allowed anymore. See, to say that the spirit this man carried was unclean was to say that he was not welcome in the community, certainly not in the temple where ritual purity was required. And so that may have surprised them as well, to see this man in a place that he shouldn't have been. At the time, if you were considered to be ritually unclean, you were set apart from everyone else because you were thought to be out of order with God. And you were ostracized for the fear of being cut off from God by association. And to this, Jesus says, no more. Not in God's kingdom. He flips the script. He's not afraid of being made unclean. At this point, the unclean spirit cries out to Jesus, have you come to destroy us? And he does just that, by destroying its ability to have control anymore, by silencing the voices and forces in the system that had allowed some of God's children to be seen as excludable. This condition that keeps the man apart from everyone else is confronted by Jesus and told to back off, to be quiet. In just a few words, Jesus teaches everyone around him that things are going to be different now. The barrier between God and God's people isn't going to last. He won't let it. He has the authority to make this change. It's going to be overcome. The voices and the forces that keep us apart from God and each other is going to come to an end in God's kingdom, even though we may not really expect it. All things will be made new. All people will be reconciled together. Now, this is a lot scarier than what people had known before. With the old teaching, it was a bit easier to figure out who was in and who was out. You could have a bit of comfort in knowing where you stood in the order of things. Now, if we're honest with ourselves, we know we still do this today. We think we can still trick ourselves into believing that we have control over where Christ acts, who's important enough to care about, what's worth our time. And when we do that, we lose our sense of wonder, where we don't stop and ask ourselves, what is this? What is Jesus doing, and why is it making me uncomfortable? We can lead ourselves to believe that God's kingdom follows our rules about who's in and who's out. And it's awfully remarkable that the people that are in are normally people who look and think and act just like us. The rules seem to be set about where God would and wouldn't spend time. But Jesus starts teaching something new. And not just through words, but through actions. He teaches what the kingdom of God looks like. It looks like a change to the structures that keep certain people labeled as unimportant. It looks like taking an honest look at the history of our country and how systemic racism, something that once openly had authority, continues to have a deep impact on our society. And then it calls us to actively work to dismantle those structures. That's uncomfortable. It looks like assuring people that they are beloved children of God when everything around them tells them otherwise. It looks like destigmatizing people who need help, help with their mental health, family conflict, addiction. It looks like putting a muzzle on the voices and structures that have oppressed and harmed certain groups of people for generations, and then slowing down to really listen to what these people have to say. It looks like being together in a community of faith, recognizing that we are imperfect. A community made up of people who are simultaneously sinners and saints, who Jesus won't shy away from. Jesus comes with the power to destroy the forces that make us unclean or set us apart from God and community. He has the authority to change brokenness that we so often believe to be beyond hope. When Jesus comes on the scene, the story starts to change. And we're shown glimpses of what's ahead and challenged to learn what Jesus is teaching, to believe and trust in Jesus' authority, to pick up what Jesus is putting down, to see that Jesus is doing the good news. Now, it seems a bit odd to call this a new teaching when Jesus said and did this stuff 2,000 plus years ago. And yet, we're still constantly confronted with Jesus doing things that teach us how to live in a way of life where all things will be made new, which is a new way. It's not always easy to understand. It's not always easy to live out. It will certainly make us ask over and over, what is this? It will surprise us, challenge and change us. It will show us who Jesus really is, the one with the authority to truly make all things new. Amen.
Canticle of the Turning, hymn 723.
Tears for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to my heart shall sing of the day you bring. Let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. From the halls of power to the fortune's tower, not a stone will be left on stone. Let the king beware, for your justice tears every tyrant from on his throne. The hungry poor shall weep no more for the food they can never earn. There are tables spread, every mouth be fed, for the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring. Let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. Though the nations rage from age to age, we remember who holds us fast. God's mercy must deliver us from the conqueror's crushing grasp. This saving word that our forebears heard is the promise which holds us bound, till the spear and rod can be crushed by God, who is turning the world around. My heart shall sing of the day you bring. Let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. May Christ's peace be felt in your homes and in your lives as we go about living out God's call to share God's love in the world and with each other. If you're joining us on Zoom worship this morning, we're glad that you're here and would like you to greet each other with a sign of God's peace, whether by waving to each other on the screen or typing in the chat, maybe embracing those who might be near to you. And also, you're encouraged to reach out to someone either today or this week to continue to remind them that they're not alone, and to check in on each other and share God's peace in those ways as well. If you're joining us on Facebook or YouTube, know that that peace and God's presence is as much for you as any of us. And we're so glad that that peace can be shared across the distance in all of these ways. Now we continue with our prayers of intercession. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us pray for the church, the world, and all people in need. God of all goodness and grace, we pray for all who share the gospel and proclaim freedom in Christ throughout the world, prophets, teachers, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders, for the church and its ministries. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all God's works in creation, plants and animals, water and soil, forests and farms, and for those tasked with protecting our natural resources and all that exists. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For government leaders, cities and nations, rescue professionals and legal aid attorneys, elected officials and grassroots organizers, for all responsible for the well-being of civil society. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing and compassion, we pray for all of those who suffer in mind, body, or spirit, all who are sick or hospitalized, people living with HIV/AIDS, anyone struggling with mental illness, for all who are hungry or homeless, and all in any need. We pray especially for Judy, Richard, and Dylan, Mildred, Dave, Sullivan, and Heather, Tom, Nancy, and Gwen, for Guillermo, Donna, and Alan, Nancy, Henry, Kyle, and Raphael, for the families of all who have experienced the death of loved ones recently and grieve, and for all caregivers, hospice workers, and home health aides who care for those in need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the concerns of this congregation, those who travel, those absent from worship, all of us who miss the joy of being able to come together in person and who await the day when we can do so again, for all celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, for the people of God in this congregation, and for other needs in our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the covenant God made with us in the waters of baptism, we pray in thanksgiving for the baptized who have died in the Lord, especially Artie, Bob, Natalie, Alex, Julie, and Dorcas. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We now give thanks for all of the ways that you carry out the ministries of this congregation through your works and deeds, and also your financial offerings and tithes. We give thanks for your generosity as we continue on through this time of pandemic, distanced, and yet still carrying on the ministry in new and evolving ways. And so we give thanks to God for all of these gifts in prayer. Let us pray. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us, with grace and compassion, with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care, and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with this same love. Through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us together pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive now this blessing. God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.